I found for my substitute a big Dutch, a boy of 20 or thereabouts, for the moderate consideration of $1,100. My alter ego could make a good soldier if he tried. Gave him my address and told him to write to me if he found himself in the hospital or in trouble, and that I would try to do what I properly could to help him. George Templeton Strong.
In July, Lincoln issued the first federal draft call. All able-bodied men between 20 and 45 were enrolled. But the law favored the well-to-do. Any man willing to pay $300 as a commutation fee or hire a substitute to serve in his place was exempt.
The law is a rich man's bill, made for him who cannot raise that sum. Senator Thaddeus Stevens.
The fathers of Theodore and Franklin Roosevelt hired substitutes. So did Andrew Carnegie and J.P. Morgan, and two future presidents, Chester A. Arthur and Grover Cleveland. Bounty jumping became a profession. Men signed up from one district long enough to receive a reward for enlisting, then deserted to do the same elsewhere. One man repeated the process 32 times before he was caught. Shaker Elder Frederick Evans came to see Lincoln, hoping to have his pacifist community excused from military service. "We need regiments of such men as you," Lincoln said, but granted Elder Evans' request. The Shakers were among the first conscientious objectors. On Deer Isle, two prominent local citizens began going house to house delivering induction notices. 149 men were called for the new draft. 42 never showed up. 33 were exempted for medical reasons. Two paid substitutes. And one man sold his house and left his wife and several children homeless rather than desert them for the front.
New York City contemplated secession from the Union, too, and they wanted to be declared an open city. There was a great deal of resentment of the influx of blacks and a lot of resistance to the draft because men could get better paying jobs than they'd ever had, and the last thing they wanted was to go to the war. There's a good deal of resentment, too, that if you could scrape up $300, you could be exempt. And all those resentments flared up into what's called the New York draft riots.
No group was more outraged than the immigrant Irish of New York, who feared the blacks, who competed for the lowest paying jobs, and for whose freedom they did not wish to fight. Democratic politicians fanned their anger.
Remember this, that the bloody and treasonable and revolutionary doctrine of public necessity can be proclaimed by a mob, as well as by a government. Governor Horatio Seymour, New York.
On Sunday, July 12th, when the names of the first draftees appeared in the newspapers, alongside long lists of those who had fallen at Gettysburg, a mostly Irish mob attacked and destroyed the draft office, then fanned out across the city. For 3 days, the east side of Manhattan belonged to the mob. Blacks were their main targets. They burned black boarding houses, a black church, a black orphanage, then lynched a crippled black coachman and set his corpse on fire while chanting, "Hurrah for Jeff Davis."
July 14th, fire bells clanking as they have clanked at intervals throughout the evening. Many details come in of yesterday's brutal, cowardly ruffianism and plunder. Shops were cleaned out, and black men hanged in Carmine Street for no offense but that of negritude. George Templeton Strong.
Finally, exhausted troops from Gettysburg arrived to impose order. More than 100 people had been killed. Bloody riots broke out throughout the North as opposition to the war increased. The nation, wrote the editor of the Washington Times, is at this time in a state of revolution, north, south, east, and west.